He's a blessing in my life. He's a man who, when I look at him, I see an example, a good example, a godly example as a father, and the way that he loves his children. It's something that when I look to, it convicts me and challenges me. And I respect him for that. I respect him as the father that he is. I respect him as the godly husband that he is. I respect him as the businessman that he is. But more than all of those hats, I respect him as the man of God that he is and the faithful example that I more than many get to see consistently on a daily basis. And I'm very thankful for this man who, again, is a man of integrity, a man of honor. I'm building him up so that he can come up here with sweat and nervousness. Not really. I want to introduce to you guys our speaker and messenger for the day, Brother Tripp. Love you, brother.
Thank you. I wasn't nervous before. Now, really, I'm really nervous. Dusty really said a lot of good things about me, and I'm grateful for that. And I'm grateful for the opportunity to come before you this morning. I take this opportunity very seriously to stand in front of you and potentially deliver a message that will change your life. Is something that, again, I take extremely seriously. I've been thinking about it a lot. I've been praying about it a lot. I've been bouncing ideas off my wife and my children and a colleague. So I have put a lot of time and thought into this. And on one hand, I feel like I'm prepared. On the other hand, I don't feel prepared at all. But we'll press through, and hopefully we'll share some things today that will be life-changing for us all. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord God, we thank you for this morning. Lord, I thank you for the people that are here today. Lord, prepare their hearts, Lord. Help them to be open. Help me, Lord. Help me to be open, honest, transparent, Lord. Use me as a vessel, Father, for your people. Lord, I don't deserve this, but I'm so grateful for the love that you've shown us, and that your power, by only your power, are you able to use someone like me to further your kingdom. We thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name, amen. So we are going to continue. Dusty has talked a little bit about love for the last couple weeks. We're going to continue on that theme, and I hope to give you just a little different perspective. I really want to talk today about loving your neighbor, and I want to talk about loving the people in your life that we claim to love the most. Your family, your very close friends. But before I want to share a little bit about who I am. I grew up right here in the county. Many of you know me. You've known me from a very, very long time. You've known me as a child. My dad is here in the back. It's hard to see, but he's back there. And my parents love me very much. We did not really go to church a whole lot growing up. We were holiday Christians, and that's not an insult to anybody. But I knew at a very young age that God was real. I knew something was going on in my heart. And, so I was always seeking him. And I say seeking him, I wasn't living as a born-again Christian, as a believer. Really didn't know what a lot of that meant. But I knew there was more to life than what I was seeing. And I remember asking my mom about it and talking to her about things, and she shared some things with me that was wonderful. But again, we were holiday Christians, and so anytime I was around a Christian that was different, they went to church more frequently, I was intimidated by them. I was intimidated because there's all these words, I didn't know what was going on. There's prophets and saints and apostles and the gospel and the Old Testament, New Testament. I didn't know all of those things. I didn't know what people were talking about. So it intimidated me, and in many cases, I wanted to walk away. And I heard somebody recently in the men's group say, why is it when we say Jesus, people in the world want to back up? I believe it's because they don't know him, and it makes them uncomfortable, not because they fear who he is or who his people are supposed to be, but they fear just the unknown. And I was that person as well. So, you know, I'm growing up in Amelia, and fortunately for me, when I was a senior in high school, I sat next to this dark-headed girl. She's sitting right there in math class. Good for me that I was in that class, and I was good for math, good with math, and she needed help, so it all worked out. But as I began to show some interest in Nicole, she didn't really show a whole lot of interest in me. She was very interested in my homework and the grades I was getting. I'm very proud of the fact that I'm a little better at math than she is. But she has a lot of talents on her own where she's much better than I am. But what I learned from Nicole is Nicole was different. And didn't know what it was, but as I got to know Nicole, I realized that, you know, she loved the Lord. And she invited me to youth group. I went to youth group. Enjoyed being around the people that was at the youth group. They treated me with respect, although in many cases I didn't deserve it. You know, I wasn't a terrible child, but I was a knucklehead. So in the spring of that year, it was spring of 97, I actually went to a youth teen event. And there, that's where I gave my life to the Lord. And from that point on, you know, I sat down, you know, saved, didn't know what saved meant, you know. I mean, I knew nothing. I knew very little, very little. So again, it was intimidating. Saved, what does that mean? And there was an altar call. If you want to be saved today, come on down. I'm like, what is this? What does this mean to be saved? So I sat with one of the adults, and I was like, what does he mean by being saved? And he explained it to me. He explained that, hey, you know, you're asking Jesus into your life. You're asking for forgiveness. And you're committing to living a different life, a life of following him, pursuing him, pursuing the goodness that he is. And I was like, hey, that's for me. So I went down and I was saved, and it was a great time. But from that point on, I have really tried very hard, even today, when there's a discussion. You know, people want to talk about something here, and I don't understand. I don't run from that. I try to use it as a learning opportunity. How can I learn more about the one true God, about Jesus, about what he's done for so many, how he's changed this world. So, you know, that's who I've been since I turned 17. You know, and it's been like this, no doubt about it. We've had ups and downs, but I know what the end result is, and I try to pursue that every single day. Fall short? Many, many times. But that's who I want to be. That's who I strive to be. And I try to be that person for my family. I try to be that person so that, you know, my wife and my daughters will see me and they'll say, hey, you know what? That my dad's there for me. My dad loves the Lord. He loves us. He shows it with his time, his energy. And that's really who I try to be. I'm very grateful to be here again and to be part of this church. Now, this was a journey. And I've got to share this funny story. My in-laws are the Webbs, and I'm very grateful for them. But they're a funny bunch. You know, they're what is that saying? A horse of a different color. I've known them for a long time, and they're the real deal. You know, I don't want you to think that I mean anything in a negative way about them. I don't. They're a horse of a different color, but they're the real deal. And they've been part of the journey, the walk that I've had for, 21 years or so now. And I'll tell you a funny story. We talk about this. Nicole and I laugh about this all the time, and I've shared it with friends. So we were playing this board game. We like to play board games, very competitive. I think they might cheat a little bit. Especially Grandma. I'm just kidding. Grandma's competitive with cards, so we played Thanksgiving night and had a good time. But we were playing this board game, and the game, I can't remember the name of the game, but you have all these people, and everybody writes an answer to the question, and then somebody else reads all those answers, and you try to match the answers to the people around the table to see how well you know them. So for instance, what's your favorite pie? And, Dusty might write down pecan, and Kevin might write down apple, etc. Then they would read them all out, and I would say, yeah, Dusty likes pecan, and Kevin likes apple pie, and okay, I matched 2 points, great. So the question was, what would you do if there was a global nuclear war beginning? And I'm very practical. I mean, this was years ago. I'm very practical, If you want this result, you do that. And so everybody writes their answers down, and somebody gets all the answers and they read them. And this is, me and all the webs. And so the first answer is pray. And, I don't even think I was guessing. But you're kind of listening to them, and you're like, oh, I hope they don't guess me. I hope they don't guess me. Next answer, pray. And I'm like, oh, man, I'm thinking about this thing a little bit, and I'm like, oh, my gosh. Third answer, pray. I said, well, three of them are pretty easy, I guess, and boy, mine is going to be so obvious. Fourth one, pray. Fifth one, pray. Sixth one, build a fallout shelter. Okay, so build the fallout shelter. That was me, right? And I was a new believer, and so I'm very practical. Very practical. So now, I'm taking that journey, I'm getting better, so now I would pray before I build the fallout shelter. So that's me. That is me. But I've had a good time being part of the webs. I love the area here. And so we'll jump right in here. So as we talked, Dusty has spent some time talking about love. We're going to continue on that topic. Why are we going to talk more about love? Love is a cornerstone. It is that foundation. When the children were singing last week and they talked about building the house on the foundation, that foundation, the rock. The rock is love through Jesus Christ, because that's where the love comes from. That's the source of love. So, we talk about love all the time. And I really believe this, folks, that we all have. Dusty had the mirror up here last week or a week before, and I do think we have to stop from time to time and really look at ourselves in the mirror and ask, are we being the person we should be? Is this who I'm supposed to be? And we have to evaluate. So I want to encourage you to open yourselves up. I might get some of this wrong. It might not be exactly what you're going through. It might not be your experiences. But I want you to really open yourself up and think about looking at yourself in the mirror and seeing what change may need to take place in our hearts this day. So it's a cornerstone. John 3:16, we all know it, right? For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son. Whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. Kate likes to say everlasting eternal life. That's the Kate amplified version. But God so loved the world. Love. Why did he go to the cross? Love. Love is a big deal, big part of our faith. Going into 1 Corinthians 13:13, faith, hope, and love, but the greatest of these is love. So God sent his Son to the cross. Many people struggle with God sent his Son to the cross. He gave his Son for us, even though we don't deserve it. Why? Because he loved us, church. He loved us. You know, love is one of those things. I felt like I understood love long ago, you know, many, many moons ago. You know, I love my parents, love my sister, love my, you know, my grandparents and cousins and, you know, then eventually married Nicole, love Nicole. But there's a different love with your children, I believe. And that's been my experience. So when we talk about God sending his Son, his one and only Son, who didn't deserve anything bad. I mean, you know, Jesus grew up in the home of a carpenter. He didn't deserve to get a splinter. I mean, he was that. He walked this earth perfectly. None of us, we've all fallen short of that. He didn't deserve to die on the cross, but he did. We struggle sometimes with, why did he send the cross? Why did he send him to the cross for us when I don't deserve it? Well, the truth is, he loves us that much as well. He loves us so much. And we have to understand that. That's, again, a cornerstone. It's what the foundation of our faith is all about. So love is in a loving relationship, you give yourself up for others. And again, if you have children, you understand this. The hard part to understand is again, man, he loved his Son that much, but he also loves us that much. So I feel like I'm beating that to death there. But now, Dusty talked a little bit about the greatest commandment. And this is in Matthew 22. And I just want to bring this up a minute here. Greatest commandment. So Jesus was being asked, what's the greatest commandment? Love your God, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. And the second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. Love your neighbor as yourself. Now, why did he say as yourself? You know, I go around and I've got neighbors, you know, and I'm kind of an introvert. I know some of my neighbors. I don't know them very well. But he says, love your neighbors as yourself, because we're all built with sin in our hearts and we're all built with selfish tendencies. So even those who don't believe they know what love is, love themselves. Do things to seek out the good for themselves. When you look in that mirror, you love yourself. And by saying, love your neighbor, and stopping there, you don't get a complete picture of how am I supposed to love my neighbor? I'm supposed to love them like I love myself. I'm supposed to love them like I love my family. I'm supposed to love them like I love, you know, my mom and dad and my best friend. So we have to remember that we're built with sin in our heart. And that's, he's using knowing that sin that's in our heart to help encourage us to love others. Now, many of us, and this is really where I really want to focus on this. Many of us have a tendency to be, we may show love to a neighbor or a friend, but we don't show that same love to our family members. We struggle with treating our direct family with love and respect that they deserve. And that's where we really need to focus, church. We really need to focus on loving everyone, especially our family, the ones that we have the most influence over, right here in our homes. How are we showing them love? So the Bible says that, let me jump over here. 1 John 3:18. If you can, you got that, Sean. Thank you. Dear children, let us merely say that we love each other. Let us show the truth by our actions. So I've got a different translation here. It says, let us not love in word or talk only, but in deed and in truth. You know, it's Christmas time. I love Christmas time. What is Christmas time to me? Christmas time is greatest love story ever. Greatest love story ever. God gave us the gift of love, Christ Jesus. And what a wonderful time of the year. So Christmas, we do gifts. And talking about showing your actions, speaking louder than your words. Talk is cheap, right? People, you've heard that before. So many years ago when we were first married, you know, I was a big hunter, hunted all the time, and need to go Christmas shopping. And I put it off. In college, I was a big procrastinator. I'd do everything the night before. So I went shopping Christmas Eve for Nicole. She had a couple of things that were very specific. Get this, right? And then I had the freedom of getting a few things that I thought she needed or deserved. And it did not go well that night. It did not go well. So she wanted some pajamas. I got to the store. The pajamas they had, they were really big. She had a pair of shoes that she wanted, specific shoes. I got to the store. I think the only ones I could find were like men's sizes, you know, and they were really big. So I got her the pajamas, I got her the shoes. I thought, you know, she'd open them up and she would understand, you know, that it was Christmas Eve and this is all they had, but I got what she wanted. Just wouldn't fit her ever, you know. So she opened it up. It didn't go well, you know, again. So I focused more on the other things that I got her. But what message did I send to her? That's really what I wanted to go back here. Did I show her that she was a priority in my life? Okay, she's the one that I kiss her goodnight every night and say, I love you, you know, and I wake up every morning and kiss her before I leave and say, I love you. But yet my actions said that I had other priorities, that I had higher priorities. Comical example, but I think many of us are guilty of doing those things with people we love very much. I heard one time, a couple years ago, I was sitting somewhere, and there was a lot of families around, and you know, somebody was talking about, little kids were talking, and little girl was saying something like, oh, I've got a, you know, young girls, you know, 5, 6, oh, I've got a boyfriend. You know, she's telling one of the other little girls, I got a boyfriend, and very innocent, very innocent and, oh, you know, who's your boyfriend? Oh, yeah, you know, Bobby or whatever. And the mother overheard this and was having some discussions with another mother. And she said, oh, I don't care who it is as long as he's nothing like your dad. And I was like, wow, man, I don't even know the dad, and that hurt. Well, why is it? Why did she say that? Maybe she said it because they're not a priority for him. And I'm using that as an example because I'm a father. You know, the mother thing is different. I don't have any experience with that. But, you know, maybe the dad, I mean, that's a hard one. I don't want to say that he deserved it. Maybe he earned it. Didn't deserve it, but earned it. You know, that's a hard thing. So what priorities are you placing in front of the ones we love? What priorities are we placing in front of the Lord? We're supposed to love the Lord with all of our heart, mind, and soul. And we are placing other priorities in front of Him. And I'm guilty of that too. Guilty of that too. With my family, you know, I try very hard not to put other things above them. It happens from time to time. Sometimes you do it, you don't even realize it. So I've told you, I really like to look in that mirror and kind of ask myself, who am I? Am I doing the right things? Am I on the right path? Where's this path leading? Where am I trying to get? Am I trying to get over here to destruction, or am I trying to get over here to the promised land and to satisfy what God has for me in my life? So I also try to bring in some folks from time to time and just, hey, give me your perspective on this. I've got a good friend at work that I bounce ideas off of, and he's very good about seeing the big picture and being honest with me. And I appreciate that. We all need that. Do we want honesty? The ones we love very much. You know, do we ever ask them how they feel? What are we doing? What can we do better? Is there an area of my life that I can be a better father or brother or son? Help me see that. Open my eyes up so I can see that, so I can correct. As the GPS says, recalculating. You need to recalculate sometimes. Claire, my oldest daughter, this just happened very recently. We went somewhere together, and we kind of, you know, we saw some people, and we came away with, whew, you know, that person was kind of grumpy. And I told Claire, I said, Claire, you know, I don't want to be grumpy. It happens sometimes. I need your help, because you see me all the time. And I want you to call me on it. When I'm grumpy, I really do. I want you to say, hey, I said, do it. You know, I'm grumpy, so I'm not going to take it well. So do it in a nice way. And, you know, make sure that I hear you and I don't blow it off. And so just this week, we went somewhere, and I was a little grumpy. I don't know why. You know, long day. Frustrating day at work, you come home, you're grumpy again. The ones I love, and I probably treated people at work that day better than I'm treating my family. And the people at work, most of them, other than work, I'll never see them again. You know, and I'm not saying they don't matter, but I need to treat my family well. So we got home that night, and we're kind of going through the bedtime routine. We have a routine at our house. You know, Daddy goes in, we do devotions, we pray. If I can get out of there without singing, I'm golden. Then I go over to Claire's and kind of do the same thing. It's usually a couple minutes later. And then as I exit one room, we need Mommy and need some water. So Mommy brings the water and does her thing. But Claire said to me that night, she was like, Daddy, you know, Dad. And I could see she was uneasy about it, you know, and I'm like, what? Just tell me. She was like, well, you were kind of grumpy. I'm like, what? 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 You know, and I think I said what a couple of times. You know, you don't want to hear it. You don't want to hear it, but I could see, you know, just the way she handled it, I was grumpy, right? Because, okay, that's not how our interaction is when I'm not grumpy. So, you know, I'm like, I said, you really think I was grumpy? And she said, yeah, you were grumpy. And I said, okay, I agree. I was grumpy, and thank you for bringing it to my attention. Now, wasn't mommy grumpy too? Anyway, I won't say what she said. So, it doesn't matter. The point is that I'm looking in the mirror for myself. It's very easy to want to deflect, you know, and push. Oh, well, I was grumpy because Mama was grumpy, and she wasn't. I was the one that needed some help with that. But I'm treating the people that I love the most in my life poorly. Poorly. Is that true love? Is that... So, we really need to examine our hearts there. So this applies to, you know, our families. It applies to our friends. It applies to our neighbors. How are we treating these folks? So Sean, let's go ahead. I've got a little video for you. And let's go ahead and show the video. So while we were sinners, he still sent Christ to the cross for us. So let's, I thought that was a good video. Corinthians 13, 4 through 7. Love is patient. Now, these are things I need to work on. They flashed up during the video. But these are things that we need work on. So let's just go through them real quick. Patience, kindness, it does not envy, it does not boast, It is not proud. You know, outside of the church, we teach our children that these are qualities of success. You know, to be, in many cases, you know, children are very envious. They're not patient. They're very conceited in some cases. Does not dishonor others. What does our actions say when we go out into the world and we look down at people? And what example are we setting for our children? Are we dishonoring others? It doesn't say, do not dishonor your Christian brothers and sisters. You know, these apply outside of this room as well. It is not self-seeking. Okay, it's not selfish. It is not easily angered. Keeps no record of wrongs. Now, I know I've had my share of wrongs, but you know, have you ever had that discussion with somebody and you think, okay, we're discussing this issue and something from years ago comes up. And it's like, man, you know, I thought we were over that. Are we really going to rehash that? It keeps no records, no record of wrongs. It does not delight in evil, but rejoices with truth. It always protects, always trusts. I love the always hopes and always perseveres. So, those last ones are pretty good. The hope. You know, how many people in this world have no hope? Why do they have no hope? They feel like they're all alone. They feel like their family has turned their backs on them. They don't have any friends they can really count on. They don't know the source of true love. True love comes from the Father in Christ, and that's what we're supposed to manifest in our life as we walk out into the world, out into the community. We're supposed to be the little Jesus, the little Christ followers. And that's who we're supposed to be to this world. So we need to continue to carry this message out into the world, to our families, to our friends, to people we don't even know, and show them this love. So, you know, I couldn't stand up here with Dusty without having some sort of prop. So let me get a prop. All right, I forgot about this one, but I've got the spoon. Right, here's a little bit of love. You know, Dusty talked about that 2 weeks. We're supposed to do all these things, you know, and we give a little bit here and a little bit there. And so today we're doling out the love, you know, and I might show a little love to my neighbor. Right, and Dusty said, look, we got to do better than this. So he brought out the shovel, right? We're going to give that love and shake a little here, shake a little there. So he brought that shovel out. Told you we were competitive. So I brought my love shovel. Amen. You know? And he might find a bigger shovel for next week. But seriously, folks, you know, love is a complicated thing, but it is a foundation for who we are and who we're supposed to be. Life is full of experiences, good experiences, average experiences, tragic experiences. And these experiences have made us who we are. They've made us have things in our life that we don't need to carry with us. They've given us baggage. A good experience, you know, positive thing. We're moving here. So on one end you have love. On the opposite end of love, the, the complete opposite of love? Maybe hate? So if you have a good experience, you move towards love. You have a bad experience, you move towards hate. You know, in the middle is somewhere, I could go either way. But we have all of these experiences that wound us. And we try to get through life with all these wounds. And we're ouch here and we put a Band-Aid there and we're trying to get over them. These experiences have made us who we are. And in many cases, that's why we need to go back to that mirror. Think about who we are and acknowledge that we're not where we need to be. We always talk about, boy, life, on one hand, we'll say something about life is short. On the other hand, we'll talk about we have time. I feel like it's, I'm 38. I feel like I'm 25. I'm losing some hair. Got a lot of experiences, good and bad. But boy, do I feel like time is slipping away. I really do. I feel like I'm holding sand in my hand and I'm trying so hard not to drop a single grain. It's just slipping by. Time is ticking away. And, you know, there's things, and I see this more and more. Nicole asked me to do something around the house the other day. I was like, didn't I just do that? She said, yeah, that was last year. It's like, I'm not being funny about it. I mean, it's funny, but it really felt like I just did it. You know, I'm at that point in my life where I have shoes and T-shirts that are older than my children. It's moving by. And the point is this, very seriously. There are relationships right now that you can think of that need mending in your area of influence, your families, your friends. There's sorries that need to take place. There's hugs that need to be given. And time is slipping away. You know, people who are at the final stages of life, they don't look back and they don't say things like, gee, I wish I would have, I wish I would have spent more time at work. I wish I would have closed this deal. I wish I would have, name it. Played more golf, hunted, fish, played more sports. That's not what they regret when they're at the end. They wish they would have taken a moment to reconcile relationships with families, family members, and friends. That's what they regret the most. That's what they wish they would have done. So let's take a moment. We'll kind of wrap up here. I want you to think about a couple of things. I want you to think about someone that's in your life who may need you. They may need you right now. One of the things that I love about this church, and I look out there and I can see so many of the faces, so many people I know. If you're that person that needs somebody, there's some here that may need to say I'm sorry, but there's some that just need to know that somebody's here for you. You can look around this church and there are people here for you right now, today. I'm here for you. Dusty's here for you. Richard's here for you. Many people. Joaquin, Alan, there's a lot of folks here for you if you need somebody. But I want you to think about that. Think about what does love look like in your life? If you had that mentor who's completely honest with you, what would they say to you this morning? What would they say that you need to work on? What would they say that you need to fix? Would they know that you're even broken? Share with people that you're broken. Share with people your weaknesses, your shortcomings. We all have them. There's only been one that was ever perfect. Okay? And nobody's ever come close to that. We don't need to. He was perfect for us. So let's just take a moment, pause in silence, and then I'll pray, and I'll turn it back over to Dusty. Lord, I thank you. Thank you for this morning. Lord, I know that so many of us, Lord, we need to do a better job loving our friends, our families, our neighbors, Lord, and even you. Father God, your word says that you're there for us. All we have to do is call out to you, and you're there. And Lord, right now, I pray that there are hearts all around this room calling out to you. Father, just asking for healing, asking for direction, asking for guidance. Lord, I pray that we will be sincerely open to hearing opinions from our loved ones. Lord, I pray that your Holy Spirit will convict us right where we are. And we'll take that conviction, Father, and move it into action as we go out into this world to be the people that we're called to be the example and the light to this dying world. Lord, the world is so corrupt. I'm so grateful that I have you to shed light on this dark world. Lord, I lift up everyone here, Lord. Father, give them answers to their questions. Help them to humble themselves and come before you, seeking guidance, direction, Lord. Lord, your love will shine a light in the pitch black. Thank you, Father, for everyone that's here. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. And as we get ready to close, I'm going to ask if Richard, if you can just jump on the keyboard for a moment. And if we can all stand right now, praise the Lord for his messenger, and that we are blessed in a house to have people like Tripp and others who are filled with the Word, who are filled with the Holy Spirit, and who can relate and share life experience and what the Lord is doing in and we can see through their lives. And right now, I just want us to reflect on a couple points that really, for me, can be everything. For me, can just change everything. And one of the things that Tripp said was, don't deflect, reflect. Reflect personally what's so easy to deflect, what's so easily to cast blame or to give an excuse or to say, well, what about mom? How easy it is to do those things. Take a moment for you, for yourself personally, and reflect to see the big picture. And if we need to recalculate, then recalculate. Hit the button on the GPS. It's never too late. There is never a time that is better than the present. Because just as Tripp said, we may get to an ending point in our life. We don't know when that may be. But if you get to a point where you are... You're on that bed. Your time is coming to a close. You're not worried about your bank account. You're not worried about your home. You're not worried about the things that you could or could not change in your business, in your work, in your hobbies, in your these sorts of things. It's relationships. The greatest relationship that we will ever have is the one that will mold every other relationship in our life. And that is the one with Jesus Christ. Amen, church? So right now, in reflection to what has been shared through this word this morning, I ask if we can bow our heads and close our eyes for just a moment. And as we close, if this is you, if you need to recalculate, if you know that there are relationships that are going on or not going on that need to be. If there's unforgiveness in your heart, if there is bitterness, if there is hurt, if there is pain, whether it be to a family member, a friend, a mother, a father, maybe the lack thereof, somebody who has that name but didn't fill that role, a son or a daughter. Someone who belongs very close, but because of our experiences and our reactions and responses, we've pushed away and grown bitter. If this is you, and you want, they may never know, they may find out this evening with a phone call. They may find out this week with a letter that the Lord convicted your heart to write to them. If this is you and you want to let forgiveness in, which is really allowing freedom to take place, allowing God's love to shine brighter and bigger, allowing His unconditional love to shine light in the darkness of our conditional. If this is you today, I ask with just nothing for me, nothing for anyone else, but as a response to God, if you can lift your hand and say, Lord, that's me. I'm the one with that unforgiveness. I'm the one with that heart of bitterness. I'm the one with that hurt. I'm the one with that pain. And I'm tired of dealing with this myself. I'm tired of going through in it and just pretending like it's swept under the rug, like it's never happened, putting on the mask. Holidays are coming, and Lord, I'm about to see that person again, so I have to put that mask back on. One more time, let's lift our hands up if that's you. Amen, and you can put it down. In a room that has hands all over that just went up, Father, we give this to you. Lord, teach us to love. Father, we thank you for your messenger, your son this morning that brought a word that has potential. A word that is a seed. Now it's up to us if we allow it to get into the soil that it needs to get into. Lord, I ask for everyone who lifted their hand right now that I know it's impossible for us and ourselves to forgive. And the harder and the longer it's gone, the deeper the wound, the harder it is to forgive. But God, you, in a world full of sin, in a world that was full of people who mocked and spit on you with every time we sin, it's like we're doing it again. Freely you gave so that freely we could give. Lord, come into our hearts in a powerful, life-changing way. Remove the callous. Remove the bitterness. Have your way, Father, in this place. May your kingdom pour out right now. May we feel that tangible love that comes from the throne seat of heaven, and knowing that the cross did not hold Jesus down, that unforgiveness was not prevailing on that day, and it does not prevail on this day. Let forgiveness ring out in our hearts. Lord, may our hearts be forever changed, not by an emotion or by an experience, but through that experience, through that emotion, through this encounter of forgiveness right now, Lord, through this encounter of your love right now, may we be the conveyor and the conduit of love in our family, as the fathers that we should be, as the mothers that we should be, as the sons that we should be, as the daughters that we should be, not because this world loved us the way it should have, but because we are a reflection of the way that you have loved us and the way that we don't deserve, Lord. It's not about how our family loves us, but in the way that you have called us to love them. And may that change the way that this world sees love and begins to love in response to our reflection of you, God. Fill us, Lord. Fill this place. Fill our hearts with your presence, with your love, with your forgiveness, with your mercy, with your grace. Help us to see the big picture. The way that Brother Tripp shared, he had that friend that would be able to see the big picture and convey that to him. Help us to see the big picture, Father. Your Holy Spirit is the friend among friends and the great counselor. Counsel our hearts right now, Lord. And with a continued prayer, with all heads bowed and eyes closed, ask if there's anyone here who does not know Jesus Christ as your Lord and as your Savior, the way that it was shared in the beginning this morning. Maybe you didn't know what it really meant to be saved, but this morning clarity got brought to your mind and heart, and now you know, and you want to make that decision. If you don't know, if you can't answer honestly that you know when you leave this world, you don't know where you're going to go when you die. Christmas time is all about the one who came. And 32 or 33 years later, gave his life for you and for me. The greatest sacrifice, if that's you today, and you want to know, you want to make that decision and ask Jesus Christ into your heart as Lord and Savior, if you can just lift your hand right now. Amen. Let's pray together. Father God, I know that I'm a sinner, and you sent your Son, Jesus Christ, to live a perfect life and die a terrible death. But after 3 days, be risen to life again. I ask you to forgive me of my sins and come into my life as Lord and Savior. In Jesus' name, amen, and amen. Church, we love you. God bless you. I promise you I will find a love bigger than this. In the name of Jesus Christ.
Let's just begin to think on God. Begin to remember all he's done. Let gratitude rise up.